No, arteriovenous malformations, otherwise known as AVMs, are vascular abnormalities. So they arise when an abnormal tangle of arteries connect with a vein. And although this forms a mass, it is not a tumour. Sometimes they do change a little bit over time, but they're not tumours in the conventional understanding. They do not require radiotherapy or chemotherapy in the way that tumours do, and they have a very different prognosis to tumours. We don't know what causes AVMs. They occur from early childhood, maybe even from conception or early development in the womb. They're present in patients and often silent for very many years. The most frequent ways in which we come to know that patients have AVMs is that they are scanned for another reason. So, for example, they're playing a game of football, they have a clash of heads and lose consciousness. We do a scan and we incidentally discover an AVM. Or the patient suffers a seizure because the AVM has irritated the brain around it, or the AVM has caused a bleed. So these are the ways in which we come to know about the malformation being there. These days, most diagnoses of brain problems are made with MRI. Occasionally, a CT scan is done, but more commonly, it's an MRI. And we now have quite sophisticated sequences of MRI. And we often do a thing called an MR angiogram, which is a particular sequence in the MR machine, which looks specifically at the blood vessels and, in particular, at the arterial blood vessels. And this can show up the AVM in quite a lot of detail. But the really definitive test to tell you all of the information that you need to know about the AVM is an angiogram. Well, as I said, they can be quiescent for very many years, and it's not uncommon for someone to discover in middle age that they've had this from very early childhood. So they often cause no symptoms at all, but sometimes they can cause seizures, they can bleed, or they can be discovered when we do a scan for another reason. So the most common, I suppose, symptom that we might see would be seizures. So on a day-to-day basis, AVMs are not life-threatening, but of course, uncontrolled seizures can be life-threatening, and a bleed, if it's large enough, can also be life-threatening. So it's a very serious condition, and it's a condition that warrants very full and expert evaluation and treatment. On average, an AVM will bleed once every 50 years. But of course, we see plenty of AVMs which have bled more than that, and also AVMs which never bleed. So each has its own pattern. Some cause seizures, but no bleeding. Some bleed, but don't cause seizures. And in some cases, we see both bleeding and seizures. And as I mentioned, in other cases, they cause no symptoms at all. So it requires a lot of experience and a lot of expertise to fully understand the natural history of the AVM. So that is how it's behaved up to this point and whether that's likely to continue to be the case or whether there's likely to be a change. And we evaluate the patient's symptoms, the patient's presentation. We look at the imaging, and in particular, we look for signs of higher risk of something like a seizure, or signs of higher risk of a bleed. And in circumstances where there are signs that these things are a higher risk, then obviously treatment is more important and more urgent. AVMs are completely curable, but not all AVMs are completely curable. So AVMs, by their nature, affect the blood vessels, and there are blood vessels throughout the head, the brain, the body. So AVMs can occur anywhere in the brain. and they can be of any size. So some AVMs can be located very close to very important parts of the brain and therefore be untreatable, or they can be extremely deep and large and diffuse and difficult to treat by any of the modalities at our disposal. So when an AVM is treatable, it can be cured, but not all AVMs can be cured.